All right, what do you want me to do?
Well, I want to make sure I'm recording. Yeah, I'm recording here. We want to hear your resuscitation of the Gettysburg Address from what date?
November 19th, 1863.
But just a few days ago, on this very porch, Frank Anderson sowed the seeds of a good tradition of making Memorial Day weekend not just a time for barbecue, brats, hot dogs, and fireworks, time off from work, but a time of a memorial to remind us about why and what we have in this country, this nation we call America. The United States of America. Frank asked me for that night, of that a great event, all these folks that were here, to do a recitation of the Gettysburg Address, which was spoken by Abraham Lincoln on November 19th, 1863. Some knowing persons might say, wait, that battle took place back in July. It's true. In 3 days of battle on that battlefield near Gettysburg, 50,000 men lost their lives. We're not counting the horses. It was July. Let your imagination rise. The stench of all those decaying corpses blew into a little burg called Gettysburg and actually made people sick. The stench of death from that battlefield. Battlefield was only 17 acres. But in there, 50,000 dead and their horses. Townspeople finally decided we got to bury these corpses for their own benefit, just to stop the vulgarity of the air. So they went about to do random graves to cover over this decaying flesh. It's awful to think about, but they did. These people lived there trying to tolerate this awful condition. They went out, began to dig graves, they buried what they could, and our nation decided that there should be a special memorial to dedicate that ground where these men died. no respect to South nor North, but that this nation might live. So they went and they found the agreement with the greatest orator of the nation. This man was the president of a university and regarded as the greatest speaker in the country. They said surely he could come here and deliver a great dedicatory speech for this burial. He said, yes, I'll do it, but give me 2 months. It's July. 2 months later, they approached him and said, we want to do this dedication. We want to dedicate this portion of this battlefield as a final resting place of these people, these men who gave their lives. Forget the North, forget the South. They gave their lives that this nation might, the Union might live. He asked for more time. Finally, in November, he agrees to come to Gettysburg and arrives at this platform. And in those days, they didn't have microphones and public address systems. Your voice projected to what the people could hear. He stood on the platform and he spoke for 2 hours plus. Do you remember his name? If you do, you're among the minority. Not many can remember what that man said. He pontificated for over 2 hours. But the organizers of this dedication, of this burial place, in this significant place at Gettysburg, also invited President Abraham Lincoln to make some comments. Abraham Lincoln stood up behind this man and spoke for just 2.5 minutes. We remember nothing of what Everett said. But what Lincoln said is now one of the greatest speeches ever offered in the history of the earth. He had a tenor voice. Once again, no microphones. He had to speak above the crowd to be heard. He had spent much of his energies preparing the speech. Some say he wrote it on the back of an envelope while he was riding in the train down to Gettysburg from Washington. Not true. He wrote it, reread it, rehearsed it. Yes, surely he may have written on the back of an envelope here or there, but they were just corrections. There are 5 versions of the Gettysburg Address. Because he was always, always trying to perfect it. To say what was in his heart. To say what was right. You and I are judges this day, these many years later. Did he get it right? He stood before these people, and here's what he said. Fourscore 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation dedicated to liberty, predicated on the proposition that all men are created equal. We are now engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so dedicated can long endure. We are here now gathered on a great battlefield of that war to dedicate a portion of that battlefield as a final resting place for those who gave their lives that that nation might live. It's altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a broader sense, we cannot dedicate. We cannot consecrate. We cannot hallow this ground. But the man who struggled here have far consecrated this ground, far above our poor power to add or to detract. The world will little note, nor long remember what we say here. But it must never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be here dedicated to the great unfinished work that they thus far have so nobly advanced. It is for us here, the living, rather, to take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave their last full measure of devotion. Let this nation, under God, shall have a new birth in freedom. And that this government